Welcome once again. Right now we're at 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Can you imagine a church service where you deliver someone up to Satan? Paul says, it is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and such sexual immorality as is not even named among the Gentiles, that one has his father's wife. You are arrogant and didn't mourn instead. The word mourn here, pantheo, is a Greek word that's used in the Septuagint to refer to those who are deeply mourning over a lost loved one. So what Paul is saying here is, you guys are proud of this sexual immorality. You've got pride and you're not mourning. You should be mourning, like deep, deep mourning, as if mourning over a death of the loved one, that he who had done this deed might be removed from among you. Clearly, this is talking about excommunication. For I most certainly, as being absent in body, but present in spirit, have already, as though I were present, judged him who had done this thing. Basically, that's just a fancy way of Paul saying, you know, I'm not with you physically. I'm not with you in body. I'm writing you from a distance, but I'm with you in spirit. And even though I'm not with you personally, I have already judged this person who did this. There goes that idea that you're not supposed to judge anybody. Verse 4, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, you being gathered together, and my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, are to deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Can you just imagine a church service? There are church services to dedicate babies and baptisms and such, but can you just imagine a church service to deliver somebody over to Satan and a member of the church? Verse 6, your boasting is not good. Don't you know that a little yeast leavens the whole lump? Purge out the old yeast, that you may be a new lump, even as you are unleavened. In the scriptures, yeast is used as a symbol of pride to sin. Because you see, yeast puffs up. If you take a pound of dough, okay, and you put yeast in it and bake it, you will have a leavened loaf of bread. But if you do not put any yeast at all in that pound of dough and just roll it out and put it in the oven, you will have a heavy loaf of unleavened bread. So yeast puffs up, makes it look bigger, makes it look heavier than it really is. You see, those who are infected with pride, those who are puffed up with yeast, they may look big, but I'm telling you, they are very, very fragile, very sensitive. They're like a balloon that you have to pop. And indeed, that's why they're looking for safe spaces all over the place. The scriptures make it very clear. You are to purge out the leaven. You are not supposed to be puffed up at all. You are supposed to be humble. Humbly obey God. Humbly deny your lust. Humbly deny your pride. Humbly deny your sin. Humbly deny what you want to do and do what God wants you to do. It's not about what you feel is right. It's about what God says is right. For indeed, Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed in our place. Paul is bringing in the whole thing about Passover because, you see, Passover is a feast that the Jews celebrate, that they make very strict restrictions on yeast. You are not supposed to have one iota. If possible, you're not supposed to have even one molecule of yeast anywhere. When food is certified kosher for Passover, those who prepare the food go through some very, very strict restrictions and strict rules to make sure that that food has absolutely zero yeast in it. It is a very important thing to make sure your life has no pride, nothing puffed up in you at all, so that you are completely humble. Jesus was humble. He humbled himself to death. He humbled himself to be obedient to the cross. He resisted sin to the point of shedding his own blood. Therefore, let's keep the feast, not with old yeast, neither with the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread. Unleavened bread, very important, of sincerity and truth. And so many people today don't love the truth. Oh, but they talk about love, but they don't love the truth. They love their own so-called truth. They love their own little bubble in their own little world, but they don't love the truth. They ignore facts. Paul goes on, I wrote to you in my letter to have no company with sexual sinners. Here are two things. Paul says that he wrote a letter before to the Corinthians. Now, this letter that Paul refers to is lost, okay? It is a lost letter to the Corinthians. Also, notice that Paul said, I wrote to you before about this, not to associate with those who are involved in sexual sin. So it's something that Paul wrote about over and over again. Yet not at all meaning with the sexual sinners of this world, or with the covetous, or extortionists, or with the idolaters, for then you would have to leave the world. But as it is, I wrote to you not to associate with anyone who is called a brother, who is a sexual sinner, or a covetous, or an adulterer, or a slanderer, or a drunkard, or an extortionist. Don't even eat with such a person. For those of you who think that the New Testament's all about love, here's a good dose of it right here. Don't even eat with such a person. For what do I have to do with also judging those who are outside? Don't you judge those who are within? But those who are outside, God judges. Put away the wicked man from among yourselves. And that is Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 7, 19, verse 19, chapter 21, verse 21, chapter 22, verse 21, chapter 24, verse 7. Paul quotes Torah here. How many of you pastors out there, how many of you church leaders out there quote Torah when you are delivering a sermon? And finally, here is yet another example of a generic statement that a lot of Christians might just kind of make it like a be-all, end-all statement, where it says, God judges those who are in the world. Don't judge those who are in the world. Judge those who are in the church. But in this same book, just another couple verses after this, in the next chapter, remember, Paul, when he wrote this in the original manuscripts, he didn't write in chapters and verses. He just wrote one long letter. Later on, scholars divided it up into chapters and verses. But just a few more verses after this, Paul says that you, Christian, will be in charge of judging not only the angels. Can you imagine sitting in the judgment seat, the courts of heaven, and judging the angels, having one angel after another come by you, and you are to execute judgment upon these angels? And Paul says, not only that, but your job is to judge the world. This is what Paul says in the next few verses. So don't miss the next teaching. Until then, seek God with all your heart. And if you do, you will find him. Call upon him, and he will show you great and mighty things. Love you guys.